Let's move on to Portsdown then. Portsdown seems to have been my life for the last 2 years or so. And I seem to move in fits and starts. Sometimes I think I'm making progress, sometimes I don't. But first of all, let's have a look at where we are. Since I last gave the presentation, which was at Coventry, we've gone from about 280 people who I know are using the Portsdown up to about 350. Now, I think there are going to be more who are actually using it that I don't know about, but what have we done? We've introduced support for the Lime SDR, and I'm going to cover that in a bit more detail. I look at the hardware and I don't think we've done very much, and then I think actually we can now transmit DVB-S2, which is something we couldn't really aspire to a couple of years ago. The larger touchscreen many of you have seen, better support for that. We've done a few things like this, and you can use a Portsdown as a repeater stream receiver. So instead of having, or in addition to having a receiver on 437 megs, you have a receiver that listens to an input stream. We've used this to good effect on GB3HV, where I can effectively transmit into HV across the internet, and it's all automatic. Have you done it on ZZ, Sean?
No.
It works from all around it.
Yeah, exactly. You can get into HV in London from Wolverhampton over the internet. And I've been trying to move more functionality from the sort of old school console where you had to log on using a PC and try and put those things on the touchscreen. And I'll show you some of those in a while. Portsdown team. It's a fluid team. There are people. There's somebody in the front row here who contributed a little bit of code, and I haven't got his name on the list, and I'm feeling guilty about. But it's a team of people who come up and say, I think you could do this. Here's a little bit of code to do it, or have you thought about doing this? So if you come up with a good idea for something to go into Portsdown that you think is possible, yes, please. You know, I saw Colin G4EML was on the chat for S-Hale yesterday and said, I found a bug in your code. Line 5378 should be A2F, not A2I. I fixed it in the development version last night and will get published in a couple of weeks. You know, it's very much a community effort. Software doesn't look as though it's changed much. You know, that's how we looked a year ago with the multifunction buttons. That's where we look now. Not a lot of change. I've tidied up a few things here. Noel didn't like that, so I took the way menu 2 and menu 3 were selected. So I tidied that up. We can now select the Lime. We can now select different modulations. So that's DVB-S2, QPSK, for example. Hardware-wise, the main change has been future developments will use the Lime SDR. That does not in any way mean that we're stopping supporting the old filter modulator board. It will still be there, but basically we've squeezed as much as we can out of that bit of hardware. So we're going to keep that capability there, but the new capabilities will come out of the Lime SDR. So the left-hand side of this hasn't really changed very much. You know, you've still got the choice between the larger 7-inch touchscreen or the smaller 3.5. On the right-hand side here, though, you need to think about how you power your Lime SDR. It is happiest when it's got a decent 5-volt power supply and it's not dragging the Raspberry Pi power supply down. You can run it quite happily off a Raspberry Pi if you've got a good Raspberry Pi power supply and you're not trying to run other things off the Raspberry Pi as well. But recommend a powered USB hub there. Doesn't need to be USB 3, USB 2 works perfectly well, because the Pi is only USB 2. We then go to Lime SDR Mini, and into an optional digital variable attenuator. Now, you can vary the output of the Lime SDR in about 2 or 3 dB steps. But anybody who's trying to manage their power amplifier for S-Hail 2 will soon discover that you need 1 dB steps, perhaps even half dB steps, to get it exactly right without blowing up your PA. You know, we're running right at the limit of our power amplifiers there, and you want to be able to adjust it. So the digital variable attenuator is a good option. Out of the Lime SDR, if you're coming out at 2.4 gigs, you're only going to get a milliwatt, perhaps a little less. The 8-band RF amp and switch will take that up to 5 to 10 milliwatts. So you get a bit more output there without introducing distortion. You can also then feed your other PAs from that, and you can adjust the digital variable attenuator or the line gain so that you get the right output level on every PA you connect. So that is where we were a month ago on hardware. I'll come back to that. The next thing we've thought about is, well, hang on a minute, we've got all these people with Portsdowns that have got filter modulator boards, and they're still going to want to keep them, because the one thing the Lime doesn't do well is high symbol rate MPEG-2. Whereas with a Portsdown filter modulator board, you can easily do 2 mega symbols and normally do 4 mega symbols MPEG-2. And some repeaters need that on the input. So they're going to keep their filter modulator board, but they're going to want their Lime SDR for doing DVB-S2 and stuff on the same bands. So how do we solve that? Well, we use a two-way RF switch. I'll just pass that around here. Simple switch, gain at, oh sorry, loss at 70 sems and 23 sems is less than a dB, gets up to about 3 dB at 2.4 gigs. So you now have a few more options, and this is of course all controlled by the Raspberry Pi. You don't need any more external switchery on your front panel, it all comes off the touchscreen.
So this jumps on to the...
This is how it jumps on. So you take your Portsdown filter modulator board output into one input of that board, the Lime SDR output into the other input, and you come out of that and straight into your variable attenuator. But that is, it's controlled by the switching lines from the Raspberry Pi. So the moment you select Lime as your output, it switches over the switch. There's no extra switchery for you to do, just a few more wires to put in. Then you can go into your variable attenuator, your 8-way RF switch, just like we had before. Full details of this will be in CQTV in the next couple of days. And PCBs will be available from the shop.
So what level do you get at 2.4 with, if you're coming through the line with that arrangement, Dave, after you've gone through the attenuator and the lots through the switch?
You're probably talking about 3 dBm, something like that, about 2 milliwatts. But gain at that frequency is actually now very cheap. At that frequency and that level, I use, there's a radio, a device that Radio Spares certainly sold a couple of years ago that Andy, G4JNT, mentioned in Radcom about 3 years ago. They're about £1 each, and it gives you 10 dB of gain at 2.4 gigs up to 10 dBm. It works, yeah. Okay. The Lime SDR Mini, you've all probably seen one. If you haven't, there's one here. I'm not going to hand it round because it's plugged into my transmitter for a demo shortly. What's it cover? Well, I think if you use SDR Angel, it will transmit on the lower HF bands, but I haven't even tried that. In our application, you can use it from 30 megs to 3.5 gigs. Just unbelievable. Very capable, but quite a challenge to drive in software. When we first looked at them, they were only available from the US through crowd supply. Delivery was not quick, and you ended up paying an unknown amount of customs duty on them. So we spoke to Lime SDR, Lime Microsystems in the UK, and said, is there a way that we could stop them in the shop? And we have worked that out. So now they are available in the BATC shop. If you bought an old filter modulator board, it would only work with the Portsdown. If you buy a Lime SDR, you can transmit using the Portsdown, using DATV Express and SDR Angel. On the receive side, you can use GQRX, I'm told, to receive using it. I haven't made it work yet, but I know it does.
Interesting. Would it work with something like the HackRF1?
The Portsdown software does not. It's the drivers.
Yeah.
It's another couple of months' work.
Yeah.
It's got some downsides. It introduces more complication. The Lime SDR itself has an FPGA on it, and it also has its own firmware. So both the firmware and the gateware in the FPGA need to be compatible with the software you're using to drive it. And this device is constantly being developed, so we've got a moving target. Charles, who writes DATV Express, and I are trying to keep in step with each other. So when you load a certain firmware and gateware on your Lime SDR that you're using for TV, we're trying to make sure it works with DATV Express and it works with Portsdown at the same time. They're mechanically a bit delicate. That's why mine is in a box with a cable clamp on it. I'm still worried about ripping these off at the end, but it's a lot better than it was. And as I've mentioned, they're fairly power hungry. They're pretty close to the 500 milliamps from USB 2. Okay, what I want to do now is a bit of smoke and mirrors. Can you all see that menu?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, this is the Portsdown menu screen. It's worth raising that a bit. Just raise that up a bit. There we go. A little better. What I wanted to show you is how you can configure a line from here. You go to menu 3, and on the left hand side there you'll see a button called Line Config. And that brings up the line configuration menu. The first thing you do on this button here, the left hand button, is look at the Lime software that's loaded on the Portsdown. So the version of Lime software is 19.01, essentially. That's relevant because that matches up to the software that's in the Lime SDR itself. So if we want to look at the software that's in the Lime SDR itself, you press the button called Lime Firmware Info. And that then reads off here what's on it. It always says expansion name unsupported, don't know why. Firmware version 6, that's the latest version. Hardware version 1, mine isn't a BATC shop Lime SDR, mine I bought from Crowd Supply, it's one of the early ones. The BATC shop ones are hardware version 2. And actually they are quite different, they visually look similar, but they are quite different. I was a bit worried when I started looking at, I had some issues with phase noise on mine. I put the oscilloscope on it and the 1.8 volt rail was at 2.1 volts. And I looked at a BATC shop one and the 1.8 volt rail was at 1.8 volts. Oh, have I blown this up or what? Apparently version one, they run the 1.8 volt rail at 2.1 volts. It's still labeled at 2.1 volts. So hardware version, protocol and gateway version are generally at one. Gateway revision is critical, 29 is the latest. You will get different results if you run this test on a Lime SDR USB, on the old bigger line. However, it is still, to the best of my knowledge, compatible with the latest software. Malcolm was kind enough to lend me his initially when I was doing the development, but I am now unable to test, so I rely on other people to tell me if I break it. Okay, the next button in the middle there, Lime Report, runs something called Lime Quick Test, which is a utility published by Lime Microsystems to test your Lime. At the top, it will tell you whether it's the correct standard for the Portsdown. That's something I've put in there. If it's not the correct standard, you get a red message there and you won't run the test. But it then goes through the self-test that they have designed into it, just to make sure. One of the things this does is an RF loopback test. It transmits from the transmit section of the line, does a bit of switching, puts it into the receive section and says, how much am I getting? Am I getting the right stuff? When you've run this test, it leaves the transmitter running. And I haven't found a way to turn it off yet, except to transmit something and then turn the transmitter off. But it's worth noting that there's about minus 20 dBm coming out of the output socket, having run this test, on about a gig. The other two buttons, which I'm not going to play with because I might break something, update line firmware, takes the current software image for the line and puts it into your line firmware. So it takes it to the right version from a lower version. If for some reason you need to force an update, say you're at a higher standard and you need to go down, the force line firmware update button does that. And that's literally what it does. It says, I don't care what's on there, put it to this standard. So I've tried to build the line utilities in there so you don't need to learn about all the utilities that the company have produced. And that's been quite a learning curve. Couple of other things I just want to show. System configuration. On menu 3 there's a system configuration menu. If you have two Portsdowns, how many people here have two Portsdowns?
Two,
three, four, yeah. And you want to take the configuration that you've got on one and put it on another. Or if you're doing a total rebuild and you want to take the configuration and save it, you can put it on a USB stick, back it up to USB, unmount the USB, take the stick out, do what you like with your ports now, and then when you get the new Portsdown built, you can restore it from the USB stick. You'll find all the files are on there on the USB stick as text files, so you can edit them while they're on there. You can also back it up to a folder on the SD card. Or you can restore the factory settings, so just like it was when you bought it from the shop. So if you think you've broken something, that's the one. Shutdown button enabled. There's a hardware shutdown button. By default, it's not enabled. If you want it enabled, you can just press enabled. Or disable or enable. This one is actually enabled, which is why it says enabled. I had this conundrum. What do you put on a button that toggles? Mm-hmm. Do you put the current state or the state you want it to go to? Mm-hmm. Force PWM open. This one took me years to sort out, literally. I found that if you use the Raspberry Pi and use the audio output of it, you know, the one with the 3.5 inch, the 3.5 mil jack on the side, once you'd used that audio output, Portsdown wouldn't work until you rebooted. The reason for that, I finally found, was that when you use the audio output, it says, right, I've got the audio output, I'm not going to turn it off because it makes a big clicking noise in the speakers if I turn it off. Mm-hmm. And the audio output uses the same hardware as does. So the audio output grabbed it. If you put force PWM open equals one into there, it gives you the clicking noise, but it means you can use the ports down all the time. It's only applicable for Portsdown filter modulator board, not for mine. But that's the sort of level we've got to in getting this thing so it's really usable. Invert 7-inch, by the way, does just that. If you have a 7-inch display and you've got one of the old display boxes where they put the display in upside down, it inverts the display so you don't have to turn the head all the time. Okay, I think that's it for that one. Back at Coventry, I did a where's Portsdown going? So I did a review of that. These were things on my list. Smooth video display on the 7-inch screen. You can now, for a limited period of time, it doesn't last forever, plug in a video source into the EasyCap and select video monitor, and you can watch it on the 7-inch screen. So it's great for proving whether you've got video coming out of your camera or something like that. At the moment, it crashes after about 10 minutes. I think I know why. I'm going to work on it. Select different stream outputs from the touchscreen. We went from this phase where people were only using the Portsdown to stream their personal stream. So you can use the Portsdown with a Pi camera or from the EasyCap to send video to the BATC streamer. And I, you know, initially we thought people are only going to want to send their own stream. But now we've got stream inputs on repeaters. You're going to want to be able to switch between streams. You can set that up from menu 3. DVB-S2, I've mentioned we've got that, and you can do every mode up to 32 APS-K. The processor works quite hard doing that. In fact, the processor works very hard doing that. So it doesn't have the capacity to do MPEG-2 coding at the same time at the higher symbol rates. So you know you do it at the lower symbol rates. But we have some solutions in the pipeline for that. Evarist finally wrote the code he's been telling me he's going to write for a year. I'm very grateful to him for it. We can do audio on H.264. So it means we can do audio in very narrow bandwidths. And of course we've added the Lime SDR support. What didn't I get to do? Well, I'm sure I can make this thing drive an ADF5355, those little 65 quid modules you get from eBay, to be a signal generator up to 13 gigs. I haven't got there yet. Again, you can get a log power detector for about 15 quid from eBay. There's no reason why I can't talk to that, but I haven't done it yet. And an XY display. You'll have seen my very modern oscilloscope over there. I'd really like to take that out of duty as a display for my spectrum analyzer and actually have it on a touchscreen. Grayed out there. I don't think I'm going to get to H.265 a low bit rate. Don't think that's going to be possible. Viterbi error correction for lean DVB. Lean DVB is the receiver that is within Portsdown, used for testing. Not really a serious receiver, but you can do across the shack receive with it. Can we get the error correction working there? No, I don't think the Raspberry Pi's got the capacity. Right, new options. I really want to get absolutely everything on the touchscreen and move away from the going in through SSH. This, for example, would allow you to configure the Wi-Fi from the touchscreen. So you, once you've built your Portsdown, you never need to connect it to a wired network. Improve Lime SDR reliability and functions. It's not perfect at the moment. I do admit the transmitter will drop out after a few minutes in some modes. You know, I've hunted after it for days and days, not got there yet. How, there are some extra things we can put on the line. We can put in whether you have the pilots in DVB-S2 on or off, and the frame size of the DVB-S2 frames. I want to put those in. There are a few things that don't work properly for the 7-inch screen. The bouncing balls being one, looks pretty ugly. I have a solution, it's just a matter of putting it in there. Right. Everest has published a couple of batch files for a PC that enable you to run the PC to do your H.265 encoding and then send that over the network to your Portsdown to transmit it. I'm not going to try and do a live demo at the moment of it, but I will set it up on the bench for people to come and see during lunchtime of this in working. So essentially you use the PC and I'll use this laptop to do H.265 encoding of your video. The advantage of that is you can feed it from vMix or probably OBS, but I haven't tried it. So you can do your nice mixes, you can bring in your external video sources, you can bring in your color bars, and you can do those transitions while you're transmitting, unlike normal Portsdown where you have to turn it off, select the camera or whatever. The PC does the hard work of doing the H.265 encoding, sends it over to the network, to the Portsdown, which applies the correct modulation to the Lime SDR and sends it up to the satellite. So I'll do a demo of that later. How many people have played with the latest beta of Minitune? Good number, excellent. You'll have noticed that it has the facility to control itself over the network, or to be controlled over the network. I would like, personally, a screen with lots of buttons. We've got 10 buttons of symbol rate and 10 buttons of frequency now. I would like a screen where I say, okay, this repeater, that channel on the satellite. But I don't write PC applications with buttons on. But I do write Portsdown applications with buttons on. If people are interested, I could do a screen so you can actually control your Minitune from your Portsdown. So I thought. And now I open the floor to you. Other things that need to go into Portsdown. Go on, Noel's the
No, you know it.
Which one's that?
DVB-S2 on the express card.
Yeah. DVB-S2 on the express card. It's on my list. Yeah. Just matter of time.
Any plan to run the software in read-only mode to save the SD card? Similar to MMDVM?
to the maximum extent, it does run in read-only mode, but it does things like the configuration files. If you make a change to the configuration, you want it to be there next time. You've got to run it. You've got to write to the thing. But when the software is transmitting, it is not writing to the card. So you can generally power off without any issues. I'm not saying every time, but generally you can.
Well, the configuration, you can, when you press a button to say save the config, you can put it in read-write mode and then switch it back to read-only mode. Would that be a feasible solution?
Yes, but it, given the number of incidents I've had, I don't think it's worth the effort. But I have made the effort. All things like test cards, you know, when we do a test card and we put somebody's call sign at the bottom of it, that is a JPEG that gets generated, but that JPEG is not written to the SD card, that is put on a RAM drive. So we are trying to get away from writing to the SD card as much as possible. But good suggestion.
Okay. Yeah. I was going to say, one suggestion I'd quite like is to be able to play out transport stream files from a USB stick. Is that possible?
Okay, it is certainly possible. The issue I've come to there is how, from a touch screen, do I select which transport file to play? So I have this idea in my head of I'm going to have a screen function that takes a list. So I now need to look at the disk, see what's on the disk, and then select the right one from the list. Once I've got that screen function working, yes, it's a possibility. Yeah,
I think that would be really useful. Because
you can do it with a file that's on the SD card, but it has to have the right name.
How much space has that got available?
14. Plenty.
It sort of half answered right. I would say, is there any way of going from the test card to camera without having to switch off and everything? But,
there isn't currently, unless you use it for an external streaming.
Yeah. I was going to ask, is there any chance of altering the name of the DATV Express? Because DATV Express software, receiver, and a transmitter, no, they're all called DATV Expresses. I'm totally confused.
That is not within our gift, but I understand the messaging problem. Yeah, I mean, the DATV Express team are totally independent from us. it might be something to. There is a DATV Express forum, it might be something to poke at them from a different source.
Well, I was going to say.
The Express is the software.
Sorry.
Sorry, I was going to ask a question. Cool. Is there any plans to use the analog devices Pluto with the Portsdown, or is it a bit?
If it was easy, I would.
Yeah, not easy.
I've got one sat on the shelf, and you'll see there's even a button on the screen for it. So, if somebody came up with the code for it, I would put the code in there. I just haven't got the time to develop that code myself.
No.
But if somebody can tell me how to do it, you know, I can give my IonQ digital values, but I need to get them across the wall into the Pluto. And that's where we are.
Can you remove that button for the time being?
Sorry?
Can you remove that button for the time?
No, I'm going to leave it there because I want you to write the code. I want you to write the code.
Well, it's fine as a receiver.
As the this is now going to run the line. The line's got a receiver on it.
Yes.
Is the RTL SDR still required?
The RTL SDR no is not required. However, there is at the moment there is no line receive capability built into the software.
Right.
I do know how to do it. It's a matter of time and testing time to do it. But it will never be as good as a mini tuner.
No.
And actually, I haven't found any code like RTLFM, to do voice receive as simply with the line. If there was a version of RTLFM that would run the line, it would be good to put it in there. But, you know, because suddenly we've got a 3.5 gig receiver.
Yeah.
But perhaps somebody can point me at some code. Wrapping up then, we've got a Portsdown test, repair and fuse blame kit on the left here. You have as much advice as you want from us today. Portsdown wise, we've got almost...
Well, not really. We've sold out of 8-way switches and we've sold out of the GPIO PCBs. But I will do a PCB order beginning of this week. And then, so they'll be here in about a week. The question on everybody's lips is, when are the tuners coming in? We were told the end of the month. Well, today is the end of the month, but I expect the tuners to be in within a week. And there's 100 on order, so there should be enough to go around. Lines we've got, so I think we've, and USB modules. UPS have got 20. Which should have been delivered yesterday, but they're going to be delivered tomorrow. So 20 USB modules in the shop tomorrow afternoon. So, the problem is we're having a bit of a hard job keeping up with demand right now. It's proving very popular. And it is actually, you may find that in various publications on BATC, we put the word volunteer and underline it quite a bit. Because I think sometimes people forget that we are all volunteers and we're doing this in our spare time, so.
You ever thought of letting Amazon deal with the shop?
The problem with doing that is then you've got to manage the Amazon thing, whereas at least it's under our own control.
Yeah.
And then you can't stop non-members buying then, can you?
Yeah, so it's best the way it is, but you do just have to remember that occasionally we do go on holiday. And sometimes I just don't feel like a walk to the post office. So you have to wait a day, but yeah.
So, Noel and I are available throughout the day and throughout lunch for questions, and I'll leave it at that.
So can we just show our appreciation to Dave?